So, if you've made it to this video, it means you'd like to understand and know how to play Aus Chapas. Rightio, the premise of the game is the same as football or soccer. The team that scores the most goals wins. Now, teams can be one or two players. There's no number of limit, really, though four people bouncing around a table and a referee is actually quite a lot. So, yeah, let's try and keep it to that limit. Okay, so how do you play the game? All right. Well, each team has 11 bottle tops. 10 are regular bottle tops and one is a larger bottle top. Personally, I like to choose the metal San Pellegrino as they have a broad lip at the bottom and they're essentially big enough to fulfill that shot stopper role. Okay, now if you want to know why I come up with this name, well, look, it's called Aus Chapas because I've derived the concept from a game I used to play in Spain as a kid. We used to call it football chapas. The chapa is a bottle top, and from here on we'll call it every bottle top a chapa, so bear this in mind because eventually that's what it means. A chapa is a bottle top and that will be the player on the field. Now, because I live in Australia, I've given it the very original prefix AUS, pronounced Oz, and yeah, that's how I came up with the name, Aus Chapas. Okay, so how do you score goals to win? Rightio. Like football in real life, the whole of the ball must cross the whole of the line to be deemed a goal. The ball must be in the half of the pitch where a player wants to score. So for instance, you've got to be in the attacking half before you can declare a shot on goal. Once a player has made their mind up to have a shot on goal, it must tell the opponent he's going to execute a shot on goal quite clearly. So for instance, going for goal or having a go at goal or shot on goal is acceptable. Now saying maybe mumble is not acceptable. It kind of leaves a bit of doubt, so just make sure you're clear on it so the opponent gets a chance to set the goalkeeper, and if you're the one receiving the goal, you get the same chance. If you forget, you'll tell the opponent that you want to score, then, and if you do, it won't count. Right, so defending player has 5 seconds to reset its goalkeeper, and only the goalkeeper, provided that is not being played outside the 6-yard box, in which case it will be stranded. When placing the goalkeeper, it must be within the 6-yard box. At this stage, I recommend you have an impartial referee so the game doesn't turn into several arguments, wasting time, and probably not making you very keen to play the game again, because it does and it can get like real soccer, a bit, emotional. Okay, so back to the scoring goal business. The shooting chapa mustn't exit the field of play if the goal is scored. For example, if you shoot, the ball goes in and the chapa flies sideways, crossing, yes, the whole of the perimeter line of the field, then it's a no goal. This keeps players from just bashing the ball in and makes it more a skillful game, a game of skill, so to speak. Think of when you play pool or snooker and you happen to sink the white ball off the black, or sink the black before you have sunk all the other allocated balls. But the good thing is here, you don't lose the whole game when you do so, you just simply concede a goal kick to the opponent team. When this happens, the defending team gets a goal kick. Is that it? Is that all you need to know? Well, that is pretty much the basics, but we have to really just get to the nitty-gritty of it. I'll put up some of the rules as they are explained to us. Look, when I first checked this in the Spanish website, they've got a fully professional league championship set up. It is quite the community sport there. I recommend, if you get a chance, just Google the way I've spelled football in Spanish, F-U-T-B-O-L, and then a separate word, chapas, and you know, even you might not understand the language, you'll definitely have a kick just by watching how they play it. So look, the official rules are the championship rules. It's 34 pages. It took me forever to translate, and to be honest, my head still hurts from the effort. But luckily, I went back to their web portal recently, and some bright light has dumbed it down and made it easy to just filter out the basic rules. So pray Lord, I wish I'd done this a few years ago. So look, I'll summarize the basics as they have. It's Spanish is a bit tricky to translate, but the idea is to make it as simple and as straightforward as possible. So we'll start with rule number one, the purpose of the game. So to quote, to simulate football game on a table where the players are bottle tops. Chapas. End quote. Rule 2, playing the game. Quote, each player has an alternate go. These may be more depending on whether they are set pieces or successfully completed passes. End quote. More on the passing rule a little bit later down, and the free kicks as well. Rule 3, the field of play. So this is moot, as though the dimensions of the goals are the same, the field in Aus Chapas is larger, and ultimately must mimic the proportions of the real field, so make it proportion if you're making your own field. Rule 4, the time. Okay, so we all play 30-minute long games to 15-minute halves. If a winner is necessary, it's a knockout tournament, then you can add two 5-minute extra time halves, or a golden goal if that's where you want the way the game to end, and penalty kicks if needed. Rule 5, shooting technique. Okay, we're going to be specific about this because we have noticed playing with new players, it can be one of the more tricky things to grasp. But just stay focused, have a good look at the visual aids which we've put on the video, and you should be able to grab of it. Now, I'll just make a note before I translate this part, because in Spanish, the word for finger and thumb are the same. So when you hear me say finger, thumb, obviously, look at the video, you'll understand what I mean. So the strike of the finger, thumb on the chapa must be clearly flicking from the finger or thumb against another finger or thumb. You understand what I mean now? Look at the videos. This is best explained visually, as the word finger and thumb in Spanish are the same, like I mentioned before. The chapa cannot be dragged during this action, nor can any of the digits be in the chapa and without moving the rest of the hand. Look, practicing will pay off later, and you might develop your own different techniques, but yeah, just make sure there is a flicking action between finger and thumb, thumb and finger, you'll get it. In the event of free kicks, or goal kicks, or even a drop kick for the goalkeeper, the chapa can be turned upside down, and you can use a technique, we've translated this directly, it's called the little bridge, which basically means you can put from the non-shooting hand, you can put two fingers forming a little bridge or an A over the ball without touching it, and that way when you flick the chapa onto the ball, the chapa doesn't go flying. And the other part, of course, is that it generates a great deal of kinetic energy, so the ball goes faster and actually picks up height. So always very good to try this one out. That's why a lot of times giving away a free kick in your own half is quite dangerous and almost can result in a goal every time. Now, rule 6 I already covered up before in the video, but just a very quick reminder. Okay, so A, the ball must be in the attacking half before you can shoot a goal. B, the attacking player must clearly tell the opponent they're going for goal. C, the defending team gets to reset its keeper, provided it's inside the 6-yard box. And D, the whole of the ball must cross the whole of the line. Okay, getting to the tail end of things. Rule number 7, placing the players or chapas. Most common question asked when people first see the game is, oh, how do you move the chapas? Well, players are static until it's someone's turn to shoot. So you reset them obviously at the beginning of the game, during set pieces or dead ball setups, and they obviously get moved around by flicking. The simplified rule says, each time the ball is out of bounds, the player placing it back chooses whether they reset or not. They have to let the opponent know when they do that. After a goal is scored, a direct free kick or a goal kick, the reset is compulsory. So you don't need to ask, it just happens. All chapas must be placed inside the pitch and a minimum of 3 centimeters away from both teammate and opponents of other chapas. So that's the minimum distance. You can't, unless there's a wall there to protect the direct free kick, really no chapa should be more than less than 3 centimeters away from each other. Okay. Rule number 8, chapas on the field and positioning. Okay. In the event chapa goes out of bounds and touches the side fencing, then it'll be placed back at the spot where it made the contact and misses a shot, so you can't use that chapa on the next shot. The same applies if the chapa flies over the fencing. Now, if a chapa lands on top of another and it is not a foul, then the next player gets to place them, normally applying the 3 centimeter rule. Rule number 9, fouls. If a chapa hits an opponent without touching the ball first, then it's a free kick. If it happens beyond the halfway, then it's a direct free kick. If it happens within the halfway of the opponent suffering the foul, then it is indirect. In the 18-yard box, it's a penalty kick. Advantage can be called by the team suffering the foul. So for instance, forego the free kick and just play on. Rule number 10, passing. When it's your turn and your chapa hits the ball onto another of your chapas in the same team without touching an opponent, then you have completed the pass. That's the ball touching the opponent, not the chapa. This means you get a second turn with any other chapas that were involved in the previous turn. There will not be more than one pass leading to a second turn in an action, except when you're putting the ball into play. So if you get a kickoff, a throw-in, or a goal kick, or an indirect free kick, that means that if you complete a pass straight after that, you still get one more shot. That's provided the ball does not touch an opponent throughout the whole sequence, of course. Rule 11, the handball. This is very, very rarely seen, but just to give you an idea, it covers the handball and headers. If the ball drops inside the chapa, well, if it's your turn, it's considered to be a header. So if you can flick it out of the chapa with a normal valid technique, then it's a header. However, if you cannot dislodge the ball from the chapa, then it's deemed a handball. This is deemed to be an indirect free kick and not a direct free kick, regardless of where it happens. Rule 12, dead balls or set pieces. Generally, the player putting the ball into play can choose resetting the chapas, so you get two actions, or not, which means you only get one action. So even if you complete a pass after you've chosen to not reset the field, a throw-in, then that means you only get the throw-in and that's it, then it's your opponent's turn. In direct free kicks, all the chapas must be reset and it is a single action. Like real football, a chapa has taken a throw-in, goal kick, corner kick or indirect free kick cannot hit the ball twice unless it touches another chapa of the same team. Okay, now the last part is going to be touching on set pieces or dead balls. So for a corner, when the ball goes out on the far end of either side of the field by the defending team, the ball must be touching the quarter circle when taking the corner. And again, it's one of those where you do have a two action turn. So you can flick it, and then even if it doesn't hit one of your players, you still get another go. Okay, so that's it. We're going to wrap it up here. If you want to get any more information about the game, you can email us at auschapas@gmail.com. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, keep watching, and yeah, when we get a chance, we'll try and get a little tourney together and bring a few players around and yeah, just enjoy it. And, you know, no matter how many of you manage to get in that tourney, it's always an exciting way to spend an afternoon. Of course, needless to say, it doesn't use batteries. You don't have to spend hours on the internet. Make your own teams and have a great deal of fun. Thank you so much.